for a lot of people, they might spend a month or two going through the course, building their advisors, doing all the research and doing all their numbers. Then quite often you're going to need to look at, if you're doing it yourself, maybe 50 or 100 properties in that area to really get an idea of what properties are around, the price points, things like that. So really, if you think you might see 10 properties a week, then it's going to take you kind of 10 weeks to see that 100 properties. Probably a reasonable time frame is 3 to 6 months, and I think it's worth spending that time. Like, if the market's rising, you want to enter as quick as you can, but at the same time you need to have some information. So I reckon somewhere 3 to 6 months is good, but look, if you want to do 2 to 4 months, then that's possible, and if you're then looking 6 to 12 months, then that's a possibility as well. But don't kind of push it out too long, because otherwise you won't take the action. So it's hard to be motivated for that long when we've all got other things that we want to do in the evening and the weekends. But somewhere around that time frame, I think, is about right. You don't need to go out for, I'd say, 2 to 3 months. All of the money is in the research beforehand and getting all your ducks lined up. The property is the last 5%. So these days, I don't even see some of the properties that effectively we buy. And there's a lot of my own portfolio that's literally a few Ks away, and I haven't been inside for 10 years. My UK ones I wouldn't have seen for maybe 15 years. And it doesn't matter, because the property is the last little bit. It could be a little box, effectively. The money and the wealth in property is all in the numbers and being able to buy two properties versus one, or five versus four. That's where the money is. Sure, you can buy a better property, but I'd say, if you bought two averagely bought properties, you're going to probably make more money than one that's absolutely perfect. Because ultimately, if you've got 2 million assets in the market versus one, then even if they're performing at 7% versus one at 10%, you're still making more money. Look, I'd love to say you're going to make money straight away, but the reality is property is a long-term game. Say, for instance, you bought a property for 500 grand, and let's say it went up 10% in the first year. Then it's gone up 100,000. By going back to the bank, you might be able to refinance, so you might be able to pull some of that equity out and borrow maybe 80% of that 100, and then you've got 80 grand. And out of that, then you want to put some aside for what we've been referring to as the buffer, to help pay the difference between the rent and the mortgage. That's almost like your emergency fund. And when you're starting out, a lot of it you'll then want to put into a deposit on the next property. And you might even take a bit of drawings off that as well, to say, look, I deserve a 5 grand holiday, I'll go away for the weekend to celebrate my win, to say that I've done something good. But obviously you don't want to waste too much of that money. So look, within 6 to 12 months, if you do really well, then you can start seeing some of the rewards. But especially in the early days, the more you can delay the gratification and you can put more into building that portfolio if the market's rising, then the more you're going to reap it even more in the future. At 24, I worked out how to refinance, which was unheard of 20, 25 years ago, and I got myself effectively a free Porsche. I was 24 at the time. There's no way I could afford a Porsche on a 3-year lease, but as usual, I'm very good with playing with the numbers. And so for me to have effectively a free house to live in and a free Porsche, then I was doing pretty well. So rents aren't really the thing in investment property. For most people, they're only gonna get 4 to 5% rent on a property anyway. So say you bought a $1 million property and you paid cash, which obviously no one's got $1 million cash, so you're gonna have a mortgage. But let's assume you didn't. You're gonna get maybe $40,000 or $50,000 in rent. You're then probably gonna pay 1 or 1.5% in things like property management fees, land tax, various other rates and electricity and stuff. And so maybe that's $10,000 or $15,000. So then you're maybe down to 30. Then you're paying tax at maybe 30 to 50%. And so you're only maybe making 10 to 20,000 per million paid off. So you've got to have a lot of properties paid off to actually make any money and to live off. And so that's why most people that would do that would then go into commercial property, where the rents could be 5 or 10%. But to me, the value in residential is really that $1 million. If it rises by, ideally I'm trying to get 5 to 10%, it goes up by $50,000 or $100,000. If I can then access that by refinancing, then there's maybe $40,000 to $80,000 there. And sure, there's some capitalized interest that you'll have to pay because your loans have gone up, but that's a reasonable amount of money, even on a $1 million property. But at the same time, I still believe in rewarding yourself as you go through the process as well. So it's not all sacrifice. You're gonna have some good times as well. But the difference is where you might have saved up to go on that holiday or that weekend away, or to buy that car, the kind of money you can make from property is, it's almost a no-brainer. You can take big chunks off the table and suddenly you're not saving. So I had to save to get my first one or two properties, and then almost I've never saved again in my life, because the money for paying the difference between the rent and the mortgage or paying the deposits, it takes too long to save, and so you need to get that from the other properties. So that's a positive. So I haven't really had to budget my household income for, I don't know, 10 or 20 years really. If you buy the right property, why would you ever sell it? And I think the majority of people that do sell properties regret it. So say you bought that $500,000 property and it doubled to $1 million over X period of time. You then go and sell it, but then 10 years later, you realize that that property has gone from $1 million to $2 million. You'd be kicking yourself. And if it's a really good property, you'd only be wanting to rebuy it back the same day anyway. But effectively refinancing is effectively you're selling it to the bank, you're buying it back the same day, but ideally getting maybe an 80% mortgage on it. And so you're doing that without paying all the taxes. So effectively, I do sell all my properties because I try and refinance every year, but I'm selling it to the bank, buying it back the same day, not paying the capital gains, the stamp duty, but I'm releasing the money, or 80% of the money. So typically when you go to more regional areas, then there's generally a higher income, but maybe a lower capital growth. If you get a property that you can put a granny flat in the back garden or cut it in two and put two properties on there, you get more cash flow. But there's always a yin and a yang in a way. So the more rental you get, typically the less capital growth you're gonna get. The more growth you get, the less rental yield. And so a lot of people would think, yes, I want to get a higher yielding property or something with a higher rental income because it'll put $50 in my pocket every week. But I think to the majority of people, $50 a week isn't gonna change your life, whereas getting $10,000 or $50,000 or $100,000 will. So I think very much for a lot of people, look, if you've got no choice, sure, go for that. But if you have, get the delayed gratification and try and go for capital growth.